Hello, everybody. It's Lauren from Christina Lauren, and I am just going to wait for Christina to join and our comment. Tina, Lauren, discussing in a holidays. Hi, everybody. All right, so when Christina gets here, I was 2 minutes late because I was looking for the snowflake filter. These are very important things. Hi, everybody. I'm Lauren of Christina Lauren, and I have taken over the Books and Books Instagram. And so as soon as Christina joins, I will add her in, and then we will talk to you guys a little bit about our newest book, In a Holidaze, which came out October 6th. And hopefully answer some of your questions and talk to each other about all of the things that we have not yet talked about today. And so let me just make sure she knows that I'm on. I'm on, waiting for you. Okay, so here's what the book looks like. Isn't it cute? This is In a Holidaze, and I will give a little bit of a background about the book. So In a Holidaze is a story about Maylin Jones, and she is part of a group of people who have been going to a holiday house, a cabin in the mountains together since she was little. And her parents and their best friends from college have been renting the same cabin, or actually it's owned by one of the families. And Maylin is a person who loves tradition. She loves playing the same games every year and eating the same food every year and having the same kind of party every year with the same people, and she loves it and she doesn't want anything to change. But she has also been in love with Andrew, one of the characters, her entire life. So the book opens and May, it is the day after Christmas, and May realizes that she has gotten drunk the night before and kissed the wrong brother. And so she is in a tailspin about this. She is also told that morning that they are gonna sell the cabin. And so not only is she still living at home, she hates her job, she just kissed the wrong brother, but now her favorite place is gonna be sold. So May throws a wish out to the universe, which is, show me what will make me happy. And that is where the book really takes off. May wakes up, she gets in a car accident, wakes up back on the plane at the beginning of the vacation, and has to go through it again to figure out what will make her happy. So it was lots of fun. I really enjoyed it. And Christina is trying to figure out where we're going. So I'll tell you guys a little bit about how we met. So Christina and I met in 2009. We were both writing fan fiction online, and we were reading each other's stories. And I invited her to San Diego Comic-Con. And she had a really big fanfic at the time that I absolutely loved. And so we met in person in San Diego in the summer of 2009, and we decided it would be fun to write a story together. And so we wrote a little fanfic and really enjoyed it, had a blast, and said, well, hey, let's write a book together. And that's how we started writing together back in 2009. We got our agent in 2011, and we have been writing together ever since. We published our first book in 2013. So I don't know if anybody has any questions. She's having a hard time finding it. And she's like, this is technology, hashtag 2020. Okay, so I'm just going to go through some of the questions that they sent us to have. And, okay, so who we are, Christina and Lauren. Christina is on her way over. And we decided to write a holiday romance. It wasn't even like a big decision for us to write a holiday romance. Mostly we wanted to just write a CeeLo novel and one that took place around the holidays. And, So we started writing the story, and initially the brother, Theo, was going to be the hero. And as we started writing it, we realized, you know, what's funny is Theo is not really the hero. We kept kind of writing Andrew as the hero. And let me just see what's going on. Okay, I can't do that right now. So Theo was the main character. We kept falling in love with Andrew, so we kind of rewrote it. We wrote it once, and then we had to rewrite it again because we did it wrong. But that is often the story of Christina Lauren, is that we have to write a book multiple times before we get it right. Okay, I have somebody asking, how do you manage the dual author writing process? Do you divide scenes between two of you? How do you get the writing style and tone to match? So Christina and I always outline together in person. There's just something that's kind of magical when we're together, and that chemistry is not the same when we aren't in the same room. So we like to work together in person, and
the process for outlining changes every single time. Other than us being in person, it's like we've never written a book before. I was like, I'm just going to keep talking until she gets on here.
Hi.
Hi. Okay, I was just talking about our process for co-authoring and how we always outline together in person.
Yes.
And
but this week we've had to do it by Zoom, though.
Yeah, we started this book. We started outlining it together in person in August, I think. And then
please tell me it was not August.
I mean, maybe, but we had other stuff we were doing in between. Oh my god. But yeah, so, but this one we were like sort of had to re-outline because we didn't like the way that we had it first. But, and then we write separately. So we end up going into our own spaces and she writes in her space and I write in mine. And then we kind of build it as we go. We put it together and we edit our stuff, each other's stuff until we start getting a manuscript forming. So It's
funny because I remember watching this documentary that talked about this this husband and wife couple that were also co-authors, and people asked, do you write in the same room? And she was like, we would kill each other. And it's not that Lo and I would kill each other. It's just that she'll have her headphones in and I will have a question and she'll have to take them out and she'll be like,
yes.
And I talk a lot and she types really fast. And I feel like it's like sucking all the energy.
It's like little like hammer sounds in your head. When
it feels a little like I imagine like impotence but with a typewriter and keyboard.
Let me lower that a little bit. That's awesome. Okay, so I made it through a very, very hapless description of Holidaze because I was incredibly distracted trying to figure out how to get you on. So yes, it was probably the worst description of our book that I've ever given in my life, and I'm sorry for that.
I doubt that.
No. I do want to say, though, just so you guys know, that you can order this book, and it is much better than I described it. It's actually a very cute book by going to the link that's in the Books and Books bio. And so every purchase supports Books and Books. And so it's a really great time to support indies. And we are really grateful for them for letting us come on here and take over. And we promise to do better in the next half hour. So.
And I'll talk about it.
Anyway, so thank you. And make sure you guys check out the link in the bio. Okay, so I made it through the description of the book. We talked about how we write together. I talked a little bit about how we met online. And I wonder how it would be different if we like met now.
I don't even know. The thing is we met when we were both writing fan fiction, and one of the amazing things about fan fiction is that it's this like super collaborative community. So to us, writing together came so naturally. It would be weird, and we're not in that community. And yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it would be different. And I think, you know, I sort of have that everything happens as it's supposed to happen or when it's supposed to happen. at least for good things. And so I feel like we met each other exactly when we needed to, you know?
I agree. And for people who don't know us, I would say that, like, our books are like, so a good example is one day my husband and I were watching The Proposal. And at the end, he goes, "I love that movie." And I was like, "Our books are almost exactly, like, that's what we write. And he goes, "You do?" And I was like,
"Aw, cutie." Yes. I do remember when they were first reading our The Beautiful series, and they were like, "You guys are funny." And we're like, "Yeah, we try." Why did pay us to write books?
So why did we decide to write a holiday book?
Well, I was sort of stumbling through that before you came on, which is just that we wanted to write a Christina Lauren book, and we knew it would be coming out in around this time of year, just based on our schedule. And so we said, well, why not write a holiday book, but make it CeeLo, so that this book isn't like a Christmas book. It's a Christina Lauren book that takes place at Christmas, and it has Christmas elements in it, but it can be read any time of year, just like Unhoneymooners takes place in December and January. It's not actually a summer book. Hopefully people will pick this up any time of year.
So. Yes. And I would say the like hardest part about writing a holiday book is that we were writing it in the summer. And it's very hard to like, I mean, Lo lives in California, so it's like summer-ish a lot of the time, but it was like 100 degrees outside for me. And we were writing, I had, I think, like Hallmark's Christmas in July on. And stuff.
That's when we were editing it. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
This just is
which was essentially rewriting it.
I mean, I think when we were first working on it, actually, it was like springish, or when we were editing it, it was springish, because I remember having to put on the sound of rainfall. Do you remember that? Because it was so nice outside.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I was like listening to rainfall, and it got me all like cozy and ready for winter. And then I'm like, winter in California is like 70 degrees, but whatever.
Which is the opposite, because when we first started writing together, I can't listen to music because my brain, I have no focus and it will just focus on that. And so I used to listen to rain, and then all of my scenes, it was raining or the sidewalks were wet, or there's like thunder in the distance or something. It doesn't work that way for Lo.
No. Okay, so what can we tell them about the soulmate equation?
What is the like little pitch that I always do? I always say, what if someone told you that there was a dating service that was based on your DNA? They could find your soulmate through your DNA, and it turns out you already knew them and they were not your soulmate.
And you did not like them.
You did not like them.
And, you know, when we first, I mean, just, like, it was fun planning that one, because we had, you and I had both just read that, the Bad Blood book, the Theranos book, and we'd just listened to the podcast, and we'd watched the HBO special, and we were, like, totally obsessed with Theranos. And so we wanted to write a book that had a startup, and we went through all of these different, like, ideas of what would be the scandal, and what would be the romance, and how would it work. Remember, originally, they were going to be, like, in grad school together, and, like, all this crazy stuff.
I think we had an idea it was a dating show or something at first or something.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And so we went through all these different things, and then we settled on this character, Jess, who is the main character in the book, and she's a single mom. She's our first single mom. Her daughter is Juno, and she's so freaking cute. And I don't always like books with kids, and I know it's terrible to say that, but part of it for me is that I'm a mom. I have young kids, and sometimes I just want to be in a world where I'm just, like, escaping back into the romance. Like, remind me what it's like when it's, like, exciting and new, and you don't have to, like, take care of other humans every night, you know? Not that I don't love being a mom, because I do, but you know what I mean.
But it's also, like, kind of a like, pain. It's just, like, in YA books, how the parents are never around, because then you have to, like, figure out the, like, choreography of where they are. Yeah.
I mean, like, sexy sleepovers, they're, like, different for a single mom.
Because you're like, oh, I've got a babysitter. Yeah. Nobody wants to read that.
But I mean, I think in this book, Juno is, she's such an ad. Like, she's not a takeaway at all. I think Juno is such an amazing character, and I love her so much. But so yeah, so Jess is our first single mom, and she is basically dragged to this startup that does the DNA matchmaking by her friend, who's a romance novelist. Her name is Felicity. She goes by Fizzy, and she's freaking awesome. I love her. And Jess isn't really that interested in it. She's a statistician. She thinks it's a little bit sketchy. She's just not sure she believes it. But after a really bad day, she ends up doing the test. And that's sort of how it all goes. And it's like, it was really fun to write. I feel like this was one of those books, like you and I know. We have some books where we're like, holy crap, every word is like getting blood from a rock, right? Yep. And then there's some where it just flows out of us. And I felt like this was a flow book, you know?
I feel like we knew that too when we were outlining, because our outline was so insanely detailed. Because sometimes you go to start your chapter and you're sort of like,
what happens?
I don't know what I'm doing. With this book, there was just always, there was just such a, like, the pacing was really, really good.
Yeah. Yeah, I really loved writing that one. That was a ton of fun. And I remember when we got it back, because we wrote it mostly during like early quarantine days, the shelter in place. Mm-hmm. And we got the edits back from Kate, and it was like, we just both couldn't wait to get back into it. Usually we get line edits or revisions and we're like, I don't know, do you want to do it first? I don't know, do you want to do it first? And it's like, we don't really care, but both of us were like, I'll do it. So
yeah. This comment, I like this comment. Mel says, so if you authors write in the late 20s age range, it tends to get lost between YA and middle-aged adults. So it's nice to read your characters in this life phase. I think Jess just turns 30 in Soulmate Equation. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, she's old enough to have her life together, but not past the point where she still has so much excitement about what the future holds ahead of her. Not that I also don't. I'm in my 40s. I love my 40s. But it is kind of fun writing people starting out in a relationship and kind of getting on that adventure together. So
there's also, I think, a thing like when you're like 30, you think you're supposed to have your life figured out. And most people do not.
We look back at that now and we're like, you're cute. Okay, so somebody says, so you guys each do a round of edits separately. So we usually have multiple things going on at a time. So Christina and I are adapting some of our books into screenplays. We are drafting other books. We are editing some books. We're promoting books at a time. So very often we have multiple things that we have deadlines for. And so sometimes we'll say, okay, do you want to work on the Rumi script while I work on these edits? Or do you want to do the edits, blah, 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 blah. And so we just sort of figure out who wants to do what. And there's never any like, ugh, I don't want to work on that. Like, it's always fun, you know? So there's no like bad job to be done. But also, usually she'll do a pass through it and then send it to me, or I'll do a pass and send it to her.
Yeah. Also, I think revisions, I used to say this a lot in the beginning, used to really scare me. I hated them. And I really learned as the years have gone by that like, revisions are where the magic happens, and having a mess but already having a mess is a lot easier to turn into something awesome. So editing is really where like where good books become great books. And also usually by that point our amazing editor has gone through it, and it helps so much to have someone on the outside.
I mean, there are times when you're writing, and anybody out there who writes as well knows that there's times where you've just been in a project too long and you don't have fresh eyes anymore. You don't have any distance from it. And the funniest thing is with Christina and I is like, we have different times in the manuscript that we freak out. So like, she is a mess at the beginning. She like flails and she doesn't know how to start.
It's coming any day now. I know.
And she gets stuck, and it's like, this is her angsty part. And then I get about halfway to two thirds. And I'm like, well, this is terrible. Everything is awful. No one is ever going to want to read this book. I don't know why we started. This is probably the worst thing we've ever written. So why don't we just throw it all away and start over? And invariably that happens. And I mean that literally. Like, we have, 28 books we've written. Mm-hmm. And that's happened 27, 28 times. Okay, somebody asked us, what is our favorite part about writing romance?
That it's hopeful. And the world is so uncertain. The thing you always get with romance is that there's going to be a happily ever after. So it's almost like solving a puzzle to take this character and figure out who is going to be the exact person they are going to fall in love with. And figure out how to kind of throw them together. Also writing kissing.
Yeah. It's a very hopeful genre. The community is amazing. Readers are amazing. It's, you know, primarily written by and for women, and there's something really wonderful about a female-driven industry. It's not to say there aren't male romance authors and readers. There certainly are, but I think men who choose to come into this industry also tend to be amazing guys. Mm-hmm. So we're sort of surrounded by really good people too.
It's also really wonderful to see women like people. Books aren't like cards; they don't just buy one. So mm-hmm. like to see a community of women constantly lifting each other up, and yeah. there's competition, but it's healthy. It's yeah. like, I want to be the best I can be.
Right. Okay. Somebody says, I live in the Twin Cities, St. Paul, Minneapolis. I love that you ladies set the hometown of the Unhoneymooners in the Twin Cities. What made you ladies make that hometown decision? So I grew up in Berkeley, California. However, I went to undergrad in St. Paul at a school called McAllister College. And so I graduated from MAC, and I lived in the Twin Cities for 2 years after college and worked with mentally ill and developmentally disabled adults. And it was really an amazing time in my life. I love the Twin Cities. And in fact, my sister married my college boyfriend's roommate. So I got to keep him in the breakup. And so my sister lives in the Twin Cities now with her husband and their two sons. So I love going to travel there. And it was always in our plan to have a book at least partially set in the Twin Cities, because it's just, it's like, I sort of think of it as my hometown, even if it's not entirely true. All right. Do you set your books in places you've visited, or are you okay with not being there to set your book there?
when we were writing the Beautiful series, that takes place in New York City, I had never been to New York City. That just shows you how amazing Google Earth is, because with Google Earth, you can literally like zero down onto the street and get details of buildings and sidewalks and everything. And like when we wrote Sweet Filthy Boy, which partly takes place in France, that was like so helpful. Now we tend to really like to have been somewhere, because I think it gives like a little bit of authenticity to it. But the book that we're writing now takes place in Utah, but not really a part of it I've ever been in. And so that's an adventure. Yeah. It takes place in like the desert, in southern Utah, in the desert.
It's like Romancing the Stone, but make it Wild West.
Yes. So, you know, that opening scene, you know, that opening scene in the fourth Indiana Jones, where River Phoenix, they're like riding horses through the like red rock. So it looks like that.
So somebody asked us why Sweet Filthy Boy never had an Ansel point of view. So if you've read Sweet Filthy Boy, you know what happens and what the sort of twist is. And so we realized partway into drafting it that the reader would forgive Ansel for keeping something from Mia, but they would not forgive us if we had his point of view in his head and he was lying to the reader. And so we keeping something from the reader. So we had to really make that call. And I think it works well in just Mia's point of view, but that was weird for us. I think that was the first book we did in one point of view, right?
Yeah, it was. And we realized we had like written ourselves into a corner and had to have like an emergency meeting in a hotel in LA to like figure out what we were going to do. And it was a really hard decision to basically cut all of his chapters and start over. And
so we turned that into Sweet Filthy Morning After, which is an audiobook that you can get from any audiobook site, including Libro FM, which is like an indie audio bookseller.
Yep. It's only audio. It's not in their own.
Okay. So what was the easiest book of yours to write?
You know, what's funny is I think that Soulmate Equation was probably one of the most pleasant, laid back sort of, even though we were in the middle of a pandemic, which it's is so really wild. Weird.
Yeah.
It felt like, I think in some ways, like we both had sort of panics about the pandemic at different times. But that was probably the kind of, not, I don't know if calmest is the right phrase, but.
Well, it's all we could do, right? We couldn't travel, which was a bummer because we had the Honey Don't List out and we had to cancel our tour. So we couldn't travel. The kids were all home. None of us could go anywhere. So it was sort of like, well, all you can do is work and you might as well just dive into it. And I think that kind of took a little pressure off. Like if all of the other responsibilities in our life were lifted for a little bit, even if the world outside was terrible. It kind of let us just enjoy the process of writing a book. And I feel like it really shows that book is really special to me. So I agree. I think that was one of the easiest books we've written. I also think autobiography was a really easy book to write. I mean, we spent a lot of time before we started writing, like strictly speaking, we spent so much time working on the research and the outline. And then also Wicked Sexy Liar. That book came out like so fast. Do you remember when we finished it and we sent it to Adam and we were like,
yeah, I am never, like, I never finish a book and I'm like, don't, like, I'm not ready to let them go. And that book, I felt like that. Like, I was so in love with the way that, like, they loved each other. Yeah. I also, Josh and Hazel was kind of special for me because I had had kind of a really rough 2016, as a lot of people did. And I was having a lot of self-doubt and really, like, questioning whether I was supposed to be a writer, which is funny because we have so many books, but it doesn't make any difference. And when we were writing Josh and Hazel, it was just a few moments where I was like, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. So that was great.
Yeah. So those were fun. Those were, those were, I mean, all of them have been, we've only had a couple that I think we would say, look back on and say that was a rough experience. But for the most part, they've always been really wonderful to write.
Sometimes they're intimidating. This one that we're doing now is intimidating. But I wonder if once we start actually getting into it, I mean, I'm going to panic no matter what, because I get this like, what am I doing? I'm a fraud at every single book. But
I mean, I think part of that too is because we don't know them yet. Exactly. So we're having to write in voices of people that we haven't really met. Like, we've sort of outlined who they are, but we haven't been in their heads yet. And so it's really hard for us to like, say, this is what this person would say. We're writing a story about people we don't really know.
Yeah, I agree.
And, you know, we also, I think earlier in our career, you know, there's all the low hanging fruit. You have all the things that you've never done before, right? And now we have written 28 books together. And so we have to be like, well, we want her to be a little like untamed and like a little wild and a little like, you know, raw, but we don't want her to be Hazel and we don't want her to be Harlow and we don't want her, you know, so we have to make sure that all of our characters kind of are their own fully realized people independent of the other characters we've written.
And that's what I would tell people who write, not only reading, you have to read because it's just like brain food, but that's where like TV and movies and stuff, because sometimes you'll see something and you'll see a character and be like, oh my, I love that. You know, this person always double ties their shoes or something really random. But when you think of your friends, like you have very specific things that you would be like, oh, Alice or oh, Nina or whatever. And those are the things that make characters feel real.
Yeah. Okay. Somebody has asked, how are the book covers chosen?
Well, I want to say a lot of our covers have been low drawing them on a napkin.
Yes.
Which we have more say on now. Most authors do not get a say in their covers. But like Sweet Filthy Boy, Lo literally drew that on a napkin. And forever it was hanging in our publicist's office.
Yeah. And Roomies, I think I drew that one. But some of them, it's just a back and forth. You know, like sometimes they'll send us something and we just are like, it just doesn't fit the vibe. It doesn't fit the evolution of our brand. But they always deliver. I mean, even when we've come back and said this doesn't work, it's not like they're like, what? We don't get it. They totally, we've had very good experience with Simon & Schuster. We're super lucky.
Yep.
So I've been really, really, really happy to be with them and we love them. And
we have published all of our books with Simon & Schuster.
We have. Okay, so somebody asked, do you always outline before we start writing? We have to because there's two of us. So it's sort of like, I know there are some co-author duos. This is always really interesting to me when we're on panels with other co-authors and people ask about their process, because I think there's just one way to like collaborate, but that's so not true. Some co-author duos, they decide who the characters are and what the main question at the beginning of the book is, but they just send each other chapters like almost as a conversation. So like I would write something to Christina and send it to her and she would write back something to me and we would kind of have this like adventure together. And then there are some co-author duos where one of them drafts and the other revises. And I just think that you would be missing out on such a fun part of the process both times. I mean, they're hard, but they're also wonderful. So we always outline just so that we can, you know, we can be involved in every step and we are like both on the same page.
Yep.
Okay.
That was a question. Why are our eBooks so expensive on Amazon? Because it's not just Lo and I. There are a lot of people who work to make our books the final thing that you see. Usually people with lower price books self-publish. There's a huge, all those people that we thank in the back of our books work to put those books together. That's just the way traditional publishing works.
A lot goes into making a book. First of all, we spend months and months on them. So that's part of the price. But also, we don't set the price. Christina and I aren't in charge of pricing the books. So I think that $11.99, $12.99 for a book is a great deal. But, you know, the other nice thing is that our books go on sale a lot. You can also check them out from the library. So if the cost feels prohibitive to you, there are other options as well. Okay, somebody asked, what was the hardest book we ever had to write?
Sometimes it's different. Sometimes the book is hard because of like what we're going through at the time. Sometimes it's the book itself. Sometimes we have to rewrite a book.
Twice the Blue Moon. Yeah.
Because that idea, it was finished. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then the idea just didn't work.
I think that one is so interesting because I almost feel in hindsight like I like the first version. I don't know that I liked it better, but I liked it. And I think part of my brain wanted to try and make it work, you know? Mm-hmm. And so when we wrote it, we turned it in November 1st. And
I have no idea how you remember these things.
Well, beep, beep, boop. But like, honestly, for, you know, a while, because we ended up moving Unhoneymooners to come out before it, because then we had finished Unhoneymooners really fast, and Unhoneymooners felt like a spring book, and Twice in a Blue Moon felt like a fall book, and so we swapped the release date, so we suddenly had more time to work on Twice in a Blue Moon, and they're like, well, if you have more time, why don't we rewrite it? And then it was almost like my brain just jammed up, because I was like, but we're done with it, right? But we weren't. We had to redo it. And I think that that was sort of soul crushing in a way, having to go back and reimagine the second half of it post-London. It was really hard. And that was the first time in my writing career where I was like, Christina, I don't have any words. Like, because she was going to be doing something else. You were going to be working on a script. And I was like, okay, I'll write the second half and then we'll work on it. And I was like, I just can't. So we ended up doing it together, but it was very, very hard. Yes. And yeah.
And somebody, a flip question, I can tell you, we're going to answer the exact same thing. What is the, like, the most emotional, like most important, closest book to us? So like 1, 2, 3. It's what? Autobiography.
Oh, autobiography. Yes. Yes.
Sorry. Someone said that that's their favorite book. And we always say, if you were to ask us what our heart looks like, we would show you Autobiography. That book just like means so much to us. We were very thoughtful in writing it. And when people say that they loved it, that just means everything to us.
It really does. That book is very special. And you can buy it through Books and Books, an indie store, yep, to support your indie bookseller, which is great.
Someone says, how do you come up with characters' personalities? It's just like,
we try to
give your best
friend real. Yeah.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we see stuff that is like just out on the street that makes us laugh, or there's like a line of dialogue in a movie. I don't know if you guys have watched, is it called Love and Monsters?
Oh, I love that movie.
So we both just saw this. Yeah, Dylan O'Brien's in it. We both just saw it like last week or whenever it came out. And I was like, if you look at the trailer, you're like, it looks okay. And then it has like 97% Rotten Tomatoes. And I was like, what? Okay. So we went to watch it, and we're writing this adventure romance right now. So I was like, any kind of adventure crack I can get into my head is good. And it was so fun. And I think like you just pull ideas from everywhere. That's not really a romance movie. I mean, it has a romantic theme running through it, like he's on his way to find his love. But like, there's just so many good ways about, so many different ways to tell a story. That one is really funny and it's totally different than anything we'd ever write. But I think we just try and pull character traits from all these different places that we've seen, you know, and it's, it makes our job really fun when we're not constrained by like just reading romance or just looking at love stories. Right.
Yep. Do challenges with co-authoring and different visions for a book ever pose any friction to the friendship and collaboration you share? No.
No.
if we argue, it's exactly like you argue with your best friend. It's not even arguing. It's just like getting on each other's nerves a little bit or something. It's never about the book.
Yeah. I mean, Christina is my, she's my soulmate, you know, she's my best friend. And I couldn't do anything without her now. So, I mean, if we argue, there's still always so much love there because, you know, we're very, very close.
Lo said once, you would never want to be in a relationship with somebody that you couldn't disagree with, because then you're not like being who you are. Think of yourself with your very, very, very best friend or your husband or whatever. You aren't afraid to be like, shut up. And
Yeah. Okay. Which character relates to us the most? That's hard. I mean, we have so many, and I think we relate to different things in each of our characters, right? So like, I relate to Bennett in a lot of ways because I'm very ambitious and I can be a little intense sometimes. But obviously I'm not like speaking to people the way that Bennett is, I hope. And, you know, I think I see a lot of Sarah and Hannah in Christina because she is very sort of patient and loyal and loving and calm, but she's also very silly. So like, there's a lot of Hazel in her too. But then I think there's an aspect of Hazel that is more me than Christina too. It just depends on like what side of the personality. So I do think, you know, there's a piece of us in every single one. What's more interesting for me is when you guys tell us who you see, which characters you see in yourselves. We love hearing that. Like if you guys relate to Chloe or to Evie or, you know, I think I really love hearing those stories. They just make me happy.
I think Lo is very Harlow. And I say that in that she's super loyal. And when somebody has a problem, she just wants to fix it. Like she just wants to fix it. She will do anything in the world to like fix their problem for them.
Yeah.
So everybody needs a Harlow friend. And I've got one.
You got one. All right. Do we have writing rituals? I used to. I don't really anymore.
I used to always have something on my desk to eat, and you just should never do that. It's such a terrible, terrible thing to get into.
Do we have any memorable moments writing any book that stands out to you both? So I have this one memory with Christina. We were in Texas on book tour and we were staying at the Driscoll, which is this like supposedly haunted hotel in Austin, and it's beautiful. And they have this really cool bar with kind of like a sort of like a dark indoor theme, but there's like cow hides on the wall and like cowhide seats. And like, it's very like, you know, I'm a cowgirl, but not because it's fancy too. And we were sitting and we were editing Dirty Rowdy Thing. And Christina's hair just looked really cute that day. I mean, it always looks cute, but that day it was especially cute. And it was just like good lighting. And she was reading and we had finished this book that we really loved. And it was just this sort of like happy co-author moment. And I was just like sitting across the table from her. And I like snapped a picture of her. And I love looking at that picture because it just reminds me of like fun travel bestie book stuff.
Do I have a particular memory? I remember us finishing the first book we ever wrote that has never been published. We were sitting at Panera in California and we finished Parted. We like wrote the last lines and we were together. And it was just so crazy looking back on it now because that was our first book it didn't get published. And looking back now, we have like 27. And like feeling like something had changed when we like finished that book, which is bizarre. But again, it's never been published.
Do you remember that time when we were stuck in that one scene writing Parted? And we're like, let's get into a Google Doc together and we'll just like write the scene like we're writing back and forth. So like I'll write a line and then you write a line. But it was like a kissing scene.
It felt like phone sex. It was so weird. We'll never do that again.
It was so awkward. We're like, okay, noted. We don't have to try that again. It was super awkward. It was very uncomfortable. Anyway, that
someone asked if we would ever go back to Parted. Yes, if we could make it new. The thing is, it was very much of its time, I think. We loved it. It's like this paranormal romance, kind of with like some Greek mythology. And there's so much skinny dipping. But I think it was very much like, I don't even know what I'm trying to say.
I mean, it was paranormal mythology, and that's sort of, that was a very 2012-2013 thing in YA, and so it's just, it's about getting an audience for that that wants that again. And also, I mean, it was the first book we wrote together, and so it's great, but it's not like, it would take a lot of work to edit it again and to make it like worth putting our names on it.
I think that I feel low that I would like to publish it, but I would not publish it under Christina Lauren because I feel like it would have a lot of, it would be held to a different standard, and it's really just a book about kissing and skinny dipping.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, let's see. Did all of the closet kissing from Holidaze come from personal experience? I honestly do not know how we ended up with so much closet kissing in that book. Like sardines, that one made sense. Oh, sorry, spoiler alert. But like the other one in the pantry and stuff, I don't know. It was like, and then behind the curtain, it's just, I mean, I think this is what happens when you're on a holiday with your family and their family and you're hooking up and it's like, this is a house full of people and there's only so many places to kiss. So I guess you're going to go in a closet. Okay. Is there a trope or genre that you would like to do in the future?
We have an idea for a thriller.
So. Oh my God. I want to flesh that out so badly because I feel like not only do we have the best title.
Which never happens. We never have a title before.
But we have the best idea, and it's just about like having time to sit down and do it, and it would just be a fun passion project because we're not, listen, like you want us to do suspense. The best suspense we've ever done was Love and Other Words. Like normally we're like, it's clear they're both in love with each other on page two. Like we do not do the like the long con in books. So I think it would be a really fun challenge, and I don't know, it would just be, it would be fun.
If I always say that like thrillers and stuff, those are like my favorite books to read just for fun, but I'm not clever enough to kill somebody. But if we can pull this book off that we're writing,
we might have the confidence. I know, right? We might be like, we could do a thriller. Yeah. Okay. So people want to know, people, a few people in here, as well as this email we have, what are we reading right now, or what have we read lately? And I have read so many good books lately. I have read Spoiler Alert by Olivia Dade, and it's amazing. I have read The Roommate by Rosie Dannon, and that is very sexy and very amazing. There is also the upcoming The X Talk by Rachel Lynn Solomon, which I just finished, and it's so delightful. I just want everyone to pre-order it. That comes out January 20-something, I think.
January 5th.
And we are going to be doing the cover reveal tomorrow for a book. So you guys keep your eye out on our Instagram, but it's called Love Songs for Skeptics, and it's by Christina Pichiris, I think.
Oh, like, not me.
It's so cute, though. I love it. It's like, so if any of you guys have read the book, it's called Loud Is How I Love You. It's by Mercy Brown. It came out a few years ago, and it seriously, it's so voicey, and it's one of my favorite romances because it's just really, really well written, and just like the tension is so great. This one has, Love Songs for Skeptics has some of that same feel to me. It has that sort of snark and edge to it and it's kind of centered in the music world. And I really, really loved it. So there's some recs from Lo.
So I just started today from Hope Lake with Love by Nina Bocci came out. I just started. It's $4.99. It's a holiday novella. I just started the audiobook because I'm usually like reading a book and listening to a book. So I just started that this morning. Then I am reading this book, Honey Girl by Morgan Rogers.
Yes, we love her.
We love her. She's our child. We love Morgan.
She's our daughter.
So this book comes out February 23rd, and it's just beautiful. Like, you know, sometimes you read I used to always joke about Morgan that I could read a line. I feel this way about Lo too. I could read a line and of a description of like the way something smells or looks or whatever, and I would know that Morgan wrote it, and that's the way this is. And then the next book I'm going to start is Sarah J. Maas's next book. We have a early copy.
And it's so good. I'm like dying. Also, Heart and Soul by Jen Frederick is out next June.
No, it's the week after Soulmate Equation.
Oh, it's in May. That's right. It's in May. And it is beautiful. It's about a Korean-American girl who was adopted, and she goes back to Korea to find her family. And she also happens to fall in love. And it is so beautiful.
He has dimples.
And it's really lovely.
It is. If you watch K-dramas, it has the same addictive, junk foody, cracky, like, feeling of K-dramas. I love it so much.
Yeah. So, I mean, I feel like we've taken enough of your guys' time. You guys can always reach us through DMs at Christina Lauren Instagram. We read every DM we get, and we try and answer as many as we can. We want to thank Books and Books again for letting us take over. Sorry for the rocky start. And make sure that you go ahead and you order a copy of In a Holidaze. The link can be found in their bio. They're great. We're really hoping that everybody supports indie bookstores this season. It's been a really rough year for everybody, but especially small businesses. We all can do our part by getting a couple of gifts, even just from these indie bookstores, and support your local businesses. So that would be great. So we will make sure to post our recs for the books that we've listed in our Instagram story. So you guys can head over there to see what we've recommended today. And again, any other questions you have, just send us a DM and we will answer it if we can. So it's good to see you guys. I love you, PQ. I'll see you later.
I love you. Bye. Bye.